teneva, teneva? And you have to answer. Che teneva, che teneva? Okay, let's try. Cicirinella teneva, teneva.
Che teneva, che teneva?
You can scream. Then I sing one part, and then you sing. Cicirinella le, cicirinella le, ale. Cicirinella le, cicirinella le, ale. Cicirinella le, cicirinella le, ale. Cicirinella teneva l'uro, non andava se papà l'uro. Basta, basta, bastarella, era l'uro le cicirinella.
Cicirinella le, cicirinella le, ale. Cicirinella le, cicirinella le, ale. Cicirinella le, cicirinella le.
People from around the world come together to work consciously in an attempt to regrow a tropical dry evergreen forest that was once here during colonial times, which was cut down for industrialization and then afterwards for peanut farming. So it heavily degraded the quality of land, so nothing grows here or used to grow here. And the idea is to reintroduce the indigenous species and create the forest again.
It's a reforestation project, a water conservation project, an education center, a community in which people live, people from all over the world. It's a place to learn about sustainability, a place to enjoy nice vegan food and see in real life things that you always believed that you want to do, like living off the grid and planting trees and building from local and natural materials and many other things. I would say the beginning of it was more looking for a meaning, looking for the meaning of life. It sounds like a little bit cliche, but it is what I felt. I felt, yeah, I'm okay, everything is running smoothly, but there's no real excitement and there's no real aim in this. And looking for this, eventually we ended up in India and in Auroville. And then we said, yeah, this is our chance to really express our sadhana, our search and our path, and to do service, which we wanted to do. We didn't want to do any more career and money and all this. We sort of lost interest in this and said, let's do something with a larger scope.
So when Aviram and Yorit first came here, they started planting trees because they really wanted to grow trees. But because there was no water in the aquifer underneath, all the trees died, most of them died. And as a result of which, it led them to rethink their strategy. So they said, okay, we'll start with conserving water.
The idea of the water conservation here is to stop the water as close to where it falls on the land. So let's say if this is the slope and a drop of rainwater falls here, we wouldn't like it to run all the way here and be collected in a lake. but we would like to stop it here and have it there available for percolation into groundwater or for plants to grow.
And they did it by means of many swales and bunds and gabions, different water conservation techniques. So when rainwater falls, there's a bund or there's a dam and it stops here. And then you make another one and another one. And it kind of encourages water to stay on the land.
Another principle is working on contour. So if we have a hill, we would work on the same topographical height of that hill, okay? We would work on the same topographical height and not in straight lines like this and go down. Why? Because if we dig a trench that goes up and down on the land, we actually increase erosion.
After that, when they were planting trees, trees had ready access to water, so it encouraged them to grow.
Then we understood that in this kind of very dry environment, you need to do water conservation first. So we've done water conservation, and now we don't do any tree planting unless we did water conservation in that area. The second thing is that we looked for different techniques to plant trees. And we planted in pits like everybody does, and then we saw that it's very time consuming, very expensive if you do it with labor.
Volunteers were not always able to dig precise holes. And eventually the idea evolved, or the design evolved, and the inspiration came from nature.
Nature never digs, right? Nature only augments.
In nature, for example, a bird takes in a fruit or a seed, or an animal takes in a fruit, and the seed comes out with the dropping. And the dropping creates a layer of moisture around the seed, which encourages the seed to grow. So they said, okay, instead of making holes, let's make mounds and put the seed in the mound. And with this, there was an increase in the growth of trees. So maybe 50-60% of the trees started surviving. And then we added another aspect to it. It's called the wick irrigation bottle. So it has a cotton wick underneath it, and the wick, the end of the wick is connected to the root of the plant. It directly goes to the root of the tree without evaporation. So if you, you know, if you pour water on the tree, it gets evaporated, but it directly goes to the root, and this again adds value to the tree planting. So we don't plant a lot of trees, but whatever we plant, the quality is ensured. So that way the success rate is about 90%. 90% of the trees we plant don't die.
We wanted to live in a place where we don't have to compromise. We felt that we compromised enough, and we want to really live the way we always aspire to and the way we should. We're thinking that we would live here. Yorit and I, and Osher was 3 years old at that time, and maybe with a few more families, reforest this land slowly. We wanted to make, you know, a very clear place with no drugs and no alcohol and no smoking and vegan food and a lot of consciousness around the use of water. And people told us, oh, you know, this is a total turnoff. Nobody will come to volunteer with you. So we said, okay, we'll just do it alone with a few families that will hopefully join us. It was pretty surprising because about 5 days after we started the project, after we moved here, on the 19th of December 2003, a volunteer came and said, "Hey, I heard in while walking in Pondy that Auroville is starting a new community. Are you willing to accept me as a volunteer?" And we said, "Yeah, but we don't have a place for you to live." He said, "Doesn't matter, I'll live on the gap between the roof, the two roofs of the storeroom." "Okay, fine, you want to live there, live there." So he was our first volunteer, and then more and more came. Within a month, we had like 15 people.
When it happened, they said, "Okay, this is something that the universe kind of wants us to experience, and so we'll create a hospitable environment for this." And I think during the course of this, one volunteer said, "May there be many more forests to grow people," which is very true, because the community aspect of it kind of promotes relationship building, promotes, of course, compassion and love towards others.
When you're pioneering, people want to join you. It's very, very attractive. Because you're creating everything new, and there's so much space for creativity and for initiative and for hard work, and people like that. So that was a beautiful first year, you know, of growth, and we understood, yeah, these people are not families, but they're motivated, they're looking for this lifestyle, even for a short time, to experiment, to see that other things are possible. And that's valuable on its own.
You can never know what will happen. Like, even these trees we are planting today, maybe in 200 years, maybe tomorrow, somebody will come and cut them. But the consciousness, this shift, this change that happens to people while staying here, nobody can come and cut and uproot, you know? Nobody can uproot the consciousness you develop during this week.
So there are two sevas, first seva and second seva primarily. First seva starts from 6 in the morning and goes on till 8:30. And first seva, people either go to the forest to plant trees or they water trees that we have already planted. They do compost and compound watering, which is they compost all the food waste that we have created and fill all the hand washing barrels, and of course clean them and maintain them. So that's their responsibility. There's the kitchen breakfast cooking team, of course. There's kitchen hygiene, but it's related to the kitchen. That's the first seva, and there's also tree care people. So people who go around putting neem juice as a portion, as an organic fertilizer, so to say. There's also a mulching team that goes around adding dry leaves and mulch around trees that we've planted so that the water gets trapped and the moisture gets trapped and keeps the mound cool. So that's first seva. And then second seva, there's toilet cleaning, there's again tree care, there's firewood, so we collect dead and dying trees and we chop them up and create a lot of material for the kitchen, for cooking, and so the firewood team does that. There's also cooking, there's cleaning the community, you'll see people cleaning pathways, so a lot of activities. And then there are people who make up activities. They say, you know, I'm an expert in this, so I'm an expert in climbing. So I can match it with Sadhana's needs and become a bees and termites person. So they climb all the huts and they plug all the holes so that bees and termites don't make their nests inside the huts. This is a short-time project. This is not a long-term project. In Children's Land, Matt is working on creating art structures and usable structures for the children from recycled rubber tires, which would otherwise go into either the incinerator and be burnt or into the landfill.
Children's Land is a place where children come to be free.
The idea of Children's Land is to give children space to either create their own activities or to join any activity that they would like.
In children's land we use John Holt's philosophy. What we do is we read his books and together we discuss it. We know what the children like because we ask them what they would like to do. And what they really like to do is play in the mud pool.
Children are coming and they're exploring and they're learning and they're stepping beyond their boundaries and they enjoy. And that's the most important thing, they enjoy deeply. How do we know this? Because sometimes when our bus doesn't come to pick them up, we get a very angry phone call from the school. Our children are, you know, on demonstration. They're rioting, you know, they want the bus, they want to go to Sadhana Forest, they miss children's land, they haven't been for a week, you know.
I'm like Sadhana Forest.
I very, very like Sadhana Forest.
Why you like Sadhana Forest?
I'm the playing games. The playing games.
Yeah, the fruit.
Fruit.
The fruit.
The tree.
Tree.
The tree.
Tree, very nice.
Very nice. The playing
house.
Game, very nice. Tiring.
We always had this dream, you know, to have a space for children to come, to own. To have this experience of just being in nature, because carry these memories of having joy in nature, this is what will help them to connect in future. This is what will help them to realize we need nature. We don't want to cut the trees.
Unschooling is basically trust in curiosity as a driver for learning. If you have a child and you think they would learn just because they're curious, you can do unschooling. If you don't trust, then you can't do it, right? The child will learn anyway, because children are curious from the day they open their eyes. They, you know, they swallow the world with their eyes, and that never ends if you let them explore the world on their own. That look, open-eyed look, that is amazed by everything in this world will never stop. But we stop it.
The people which still holding some fears or don't agree with this way or think, you know, this is a mistake and this, that they come and says you are experimenting with your children. And but they think everybody is experimenting.
If they have anything that we can help them with, they say, okay, I want to understand something that I don't know, can you help me? And then you can help them. To give you an example, when Osher, my elder daughter, was a few years old, she asked, why does the moon rise every day in a different hour? I said, you know, I roughly understand it from geography class in like seventh grade, but I'm not sure I can really explain it well. But let's ask. So we went to lunch in the main hut, and we asked the volunteers, anybody can explain us why the moon is rising every day in a different hour? And one guy says, yeah, I studied astronomy. I'd be very happy to explain this. So in the night, he did a demonstration, and many of us came. Many of the volunteers also wanted to understand it. And he took a tennis ball and a flashlight and a globe, and he did a full demonstration, and first time I really understood it. So it was really nice, and she understood it. It's between Google, YouTube, the volunteers, and outside resources, we find an answer to almost every question.
People come here, even if they don't choose to unschool the children, or the children goes, they spend some time, then goes to school. They keep some memory of this sense of freedom. And what does it mean, sense of freedom? The sense of freedom, it's the opportunity to be in touch with yourself.
Here, I'll go.
It's Sadhana Forest is not an organization, it's an organism. And it's such a beautiful thought because just like any organism, it's constantly evolving.
You know, we evolved within the years and chose veganism. And when we started Sadhana Forest, we raised this question, should the community be all vegan or should we be vegan and we should let the community, let's say, be vegetarian? Because people said, vegan community, like no alcohol, no drugs, you know, no cigarettes, no cheese, no eggs, like you will end up with 5 volunteers. Then, yeah, it was a process of thinking and understanding what do we want, how do we want to live our life. And we realized that, first of all, Sadhana Forest is our home. It's the place where we raise our children. And we decided that we want to create a vegan environment. And you know, we end up with 1,000 volunteer a year. I think these fears had no real base. Like, and today, but I can say even the opposite. Like veganism, it's a growing movement all over the world. And I think today suddenly we do receive volunteers because of veganism, you know?
We love animals, we respect them. We wanna live in harmony and in mutual respect with them. And I wouldn't do to an animal what I wouldn't do to my family. So I wouldn't kill them or tie them or milk them against their will or do all these things because I feel that it's not appropriate. It's not appropriate for people and it's not appropriate for animals.
The calves are separated from the cows for those who eat beef or even drink milk so that the milk can then be taken from the mother cow and not given to the calf. And many other aspects, health aspects, environmental aspects. 3/4 of all the rainforests that are cut down not to grow, they're cut down to grow soy and corn, but not to feed human beings, but to feed cattle. And it's really sad because there's 18 million cattle around the world, and there's enough food to feed 18 million cattle, so it could very well feed 6-7 million people in the world.
The reason we built our Sadhana Forest as it is that when we had the idea to plant trees, we were thinking about what is we're going to do, what's the meaning of what we are going to do, and we decided for ourselves that we will not be satisfied with only to plant trees, because we can plant trees, but on the other hand, we can cook on gas, and connect to TNB, and build our houses from cement. So at the end of the day, you know, where is the balance? So we said, no, we want to be aware on every step that we are choosing. You know, we're still in that point. We never thought about a community with volunteers as a learning center. You know, it was not there. We said, how we choose to live our life. In which kind of awareness says, okay, so first step is we want to plant trees. Yes, we want to make this planet more green. But should we consider also our other steps, you know? Should we be aware about other things? So structures, it's one of the way. And living in Tamil Nadu, in this specific place, you know, we started to explore what is the local ways and the local traditions of a construction of dealing with the heat, what is the most appropriate, you know, for this climate. And we made a collection of the experience of the villages, of the experience of Orvillians that came here much before us and, you know, used all these techniques. And we learned a lot from all this experience. And we did also some mistakes in the beginning that cost us in the first cyclone, 4 or 5 months after we came, you know, we lost like tree structures because we didn't understand deeply. But, you know, every step is a learning step. The structures are, you know, like are built by local materials, which has a lot of wisdom behind every choice. You know, the ropes, these pieces that they connect the palms, you know, into the structure itself. Yeah, this is a part of a shell of a fruit, palai they call it, and they take it and they just take out strings from it, like, and it's fascinating, you know, to learn, to see, and also to realize how amazing these structures. I remember the first night in our hut, I felt like I'm in a palace. There are two very important features I can say about the way we live. We live with no doors, we live with no walls. Because something happens also for your soul the moment you're in an open structure, like it's kind of you open yourself. We are not attached, not to a place, not to the concept, not to, you know, not to anything. We are doing what we need, what we feel we need to do.
The future of Sadhana Forest looks bright, in the sense that I think we're exactly in the right time, in the right place. We're talking about issues that are very relevant, that are very alive for people. Maybe 20 years earlier, we have been too early. 20 years later, would have been maybe too late in a way. I think it's exactly the right time. There's a lot of the awareness building up in the world about the impact of food on the environment, food production, the issue of reforestation and the issue of global warming, which is driving a lot of the changes, because it's a sort of a pistol that is on our head as humanity, and usually under threat, we as people we function a bit better. So I think that we are there with very practical, tangible solutions, and that's what we want to be. You know, we want to be relevant to the processes that are going, and that's why we have over 1,000 volunteers coming here in India. Otherwise, they wouldn't come if it wouldn't be relevant, you know, for them. People are looking for a change. They're looking for a positive change, not for demonstrating against, but for working for something. There are many options where to express your anger about things that you think are going wrong. But that's not Sadhana Forest. Sadhana Forest is only about positivity. It's only about creation of solutions. It's not about working against anyone, even if we don't agree with them. So I think that's something very attractive for people. Oh, I can be involved in a positive, peaceful, beautiful way in creating a change. With this, I think the future is ours.
Shout out,